والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيبي وحبيب الله العالمين أبا القاسم محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
قال أمير المؤمنين علي عليه أفضل الصلاة وأزكى السلام في رواية ينقل عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم أنه قال يا علي أوصيك بخصال فاحفظها وصدق أمير المؤمنين علي عليه السلام اللهم
صل على محمد وآل محمد.
My dear brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi
wa barakatuh. Tonight, I would like to share with you some of the sayings of the Prophet, which in the hadith, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam was given some golden advices to Imam Ali alayhi salam. This hadith, you can find it in Usul al-Kafi. You can find it in 40 hadith of Imam Khomeini rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi and some other books. But I just wanted to mention that hadith and elaborate some of the points about those words of the Prophet to Imam Ali alayhi salam. Because really, I believe if every one of us can practice those sayings of the Prophet, just materialize those sayings in our life, trust me, it's enough to take you to heaven.
MashaAllah.
If you are just to practice, if you say, I'm not going to do anything other than these golden words of the Prophet, I guarantee you, if you stick to them, it's enough to send you to heaven. These are the sayings of the Prophet. This hadith, the Holy Prophet said to Imam Ali, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, I have some advices for you. And I want you to listen to them very carefully. And not only to listen to them carefully, I want you to practice them as well. And then he said, Allahumma a'in. Ya Allah,
help.
Allah, that's the first lesson that I would like to share with you. When the Prophet is saying to Allah, Allahumma a'inhu, Ya Allah, help him, what does it mean? It means nobody can do any good unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helps him. Any good things you are able to do for anybody, for yourself, for somebody else, always keep in mind, it's not you, it's tawfiq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because sometimes, when we get tawfiq to do something small, to others, to ourselves, for example, let's say I was able to help a poor person, a needy, then I started to think, look, how good I am. MashaAllah, I'm the greatest mu'min. See, I'm helping somebody. Then my heart started to feel arrogant. You know, there is one dua of Imam al-Zaman, ajjalallahu ta'ala, for us. Inshallah, someday when we get a chance, it's a good dua to elaborate the sayings of the Imam. In that dua, our 12th Imam, when he started to talk to Allah, he said, Allahumma rzuqna tawfiq al-ta'ah. Ya Allah, grant us the tawfiq to be able to obey you. Meaning, to be obedient to Allah, you need Allah's tawfiq. That is how much this is important. Now, if I'm able to pray my Zuhr prayer, that is why when you see when we pray any salah, it's mustahab to do what we call sajda to shukr. To thank Allah, that Ya Allah, thank you for giving me this tawfiq to perform my prayers, especially if I'm able to do it on time. That's tawfiq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So anytime you are able to do something positive, remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that it is His tawfiq, it's His help that made you to be able to do that good thing. That is why the Prophet here says, Allahumma, oh Allah, help him so he's able to do all these advices. But how many are those advices? I counted them one by one, and I found those advices, they are 12 in number. Like the number of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. The first one of those advice that the Prophet is telling Imam Ali, he say, Ya Ali, la yakhrujanna fi fika kadhibatun abadan. Ya Ali, be careful. That whatever comes out of your mouth, I say, be careful, never ever make it to be a lie. In other words, never ever lie. Allah. You know, most of our marriages, that goes through problem, one of the problems is lying. The husband lied to the wife, and the wife lied to the husband. After a while, they end up with the Maulana, we want divorce. What happened? Because Mr. A or Mr. B lies. I can't stand his lying. Now, if Mr. A will stop lying, the marriage will have been won. Perfect. That is one of the problems of lying. Lying is one of the major problems in every world and every standard. You go to any religion, you go to any community, whether they are Muslim or not, they tell you lying is not a good thing. A person lying in the community, in the family, nobody likes him. Whether you're Muslim or not, because nobody wants to be lied to. Everybody wants to be told truth to. Imam Ali alayhi salam said, and the Prophet is telling Imam Ali, Ya Ali, never ever lie to anybody. And I tell you, brothers, you know the importance of not lying and telling the truth even in the Quran. Allah said, a person who lies deserves la'na of Allah. The person who lies, now we say to the killers of Ahlul Bayt, la'natullah alayhim, right? Now the person who lies, Allah said that he or she deserves la'na of Allah. Read Surah Ali Imran. فَمَنْ حَاجَّكَ فِيهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَكَ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ فَقُلْ تَعَالَوْ نَدْعُ أَبْنَاءَنَا وَأَبْنَاءَكُمْ وَنِسَاءَنَا وَنِسَاءَكُمْ وَأَنفُسَنَا وَأَنفُسَكُمْ ثُمَّ نَبْتَهِلْ فَنَجْعَلْ لَعْنَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْكَاذِبِينَ. الكاذب is a liar. The liar, he deserves the la'na of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet, when he talks about the importance of telling the truth, he said, one of the things that I love children, one of the reasons why I love children is that they don't know anything called lying. إني أحب من الصبيان سبع. I love 7 things from children. One of them, he says, صدقهم الحديث. They always tell the truth. Allahu Akbar. Except if the parents turn them from children, when you see them lying, Allah is not from them. They're from the parents. Right? Sometimes we do some things, we turn the children to start lying to us, and then we tell us, how did you become a liar? How did you learn a lie? No, from mom and dad. You know how? Now I'll give you some examples that our scholars they mentioned, and this is for every one of us. You know, sometimes a child is growing in the house. He doesn't know anything lying. He doesn't know any lie. He's always pure, clean. Sometimes our habit as a parent turns the child to a liar. Number one, too much pressure on the child can turn the child to tell lies. Too pressure. Sometimes a child breaks a glass in the house by mistake. Sometimes intentional, right? They're playing with the glass. They're not supposed to, but that's what the children do anyway. Right? They do things they're not supposed to do, and they do it anyway because they are children. That's why we call them children. Because an adult wouldn't do that. Now, what do? They break the glass. A mom and dad comes to the kitchen. Oh, the glass is broken. Allah Akbar. Who broke the glass? That was me. Why did he break the glass? Tack! MashaAllah. Then he's gotta get it slap and he's gotta hit it. Right? Go, he learned a lesson. Next time he breaks the glass, who broke the glass? I don't know. What happened? Yesterday he said, I did it. But today he says, I don't know. What happened? Because of that pressure he got, now it turns him to lie. Because of, if the parents will say, okay, don't do that next time. Be careful. You might get hurt. This costs money. Don't do that again. That's it. Next time he breaks the glass, or he does something wrong, he tells the parent, I did it. And he's telling the truth. That's one. Number two, sometimes this pressure, and this is from Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, they say sometimes the pressure might turn the child not only to be a liar, to even criminal, God forbid. What is it? Sometimes he does something wrong, right? And he has a siblings, older or younger. Now, because of the pressure, not only he doesn't say, I did it, now he tells them, oh, Muhammad did it. Okay, Muhammad didn't even do it. But now, he's lying not that he didn't do it, and now he is even putting it on other people who are innocent. Why? Because of the pressure. And who teach the child to lie? The parent. And he know it. The psychologist, they said, when a father or the mother, right, sometimes in the house, somebody walks into a house, he talks too much. And you know, sometimes you have some people, when they come to your house, they love to talk. They don't know anything called comma or full stop. MashaAllah, from there, man, they keep going on and on and on and on. But Allah's created some people like that. Now, they come to your door, you look at the window, oh my God, the brother is here again. Now what do I do? How do I get rid of him? I say, Muhammad, come here. Yes, Muhammad comes. Muhammad, go tell him that daddy's not home. Right? Now as soon as you tell the Muhammad, go tell the man, daddy's not home. The scholars say the child, between from the father to the person, automatically they turn like three times. Three times they turn to look. What am I going to tell the person? Is it real or not? Allahu Akbar. Because his nature is telling him that now, daddy is here. But why am I saying daddy's not here? Now, he goes there. The children who are a little older, they say daddy's not here. Right? Now you taught him how to lie. But those who are so innocent, they don't know how to lie. They say, daddy said to tell you he's not home. Ah, the person knows, ah, daddy's home, but he doesn't want me to come, so now he's telling you to tell me he's not. Then he got to know that now the father is home. Now the child learns how to lie from these kind of things. That is what is very important. As a parent, at home, we have to teach our children telling the truth. And telling the truth is one of the character of mu'mineen. Imam Ali alayhi salam, he said, he said, ma kadhibt, he said, I never told a lie, I never lied, منذ علمت أن الله يمقت أهله. From the one I knew, Allah doesn't like people who lie. You know when is that? In Alam al-Dharr. Imam Ali knew that Allah doesn't like people who lie, he never lied. Doesn't matter. It doesn't matter which situation I found myself in, I have to not to lie. Even exception, there are some exceptions our scholars mentioned, that those set exceptions is okay, but they said it's better to use what we call tawriya. MashaAllah, today some people learn tawriya, and everything is about tawriya. Tawriya means what? It's allowed in Islam that you say something that has two faces. Say something, it has two faces. It can mean A or B, right? Now the person who's asking you, or the person you're telling, he might thinking A while you're thinking about B. Right? For example, I tell someone, somebody comes in, and then he tells him, for example, you tell a zalim, an oppressor, like Zayd is not here. But you mean here means this place. He might be in another room. But when you tell him, he's not here, your intention is not here where you're standing. But the listener, he's thinking about what? And the house, the complete house you're talking about. This is called tawriya. This is in the case of one saving a life. If I know Somebody's want to kill somebody, want to hurt somebody. Now I can use this as tawriyah to save a life. That is one. Number two. And the situation where you are reconciling between the two people. It's okay. But that also, you use tawriyah. Number three. During the war, when you're fighting the enemies, in order to achieve the victory, there's an FA requires some kind of tawriyah, then you're allowed to do that. But other than that, no, you're not allowed to do that. That is how Islam emphasized about the importance of telling the truth. The Prophet told Imam Ali, لَا يَخْرُجَنَّ فِي فِيكْ كَذِبَةٌ أَبَدًا. Never! No, under any circumstance, never tell lie with anybody. That is advice number one. And now you know, mashallah, if you want to go into the details, lie comes in different stages. Sometimes lying in action. Some of us, we go to work and we have to sign a certain time. Right? I came late. Right? Alhamdulillah, today some of the companies, they have these machines. You can lie. Right? Because the time that you come, some of them you have to put your fingers and then you tell the time that you come in. Now, there are certain places you have to write it down. I come at 8 o'clock, I write 7:15. I know that I'm not here at this time, that's lying. And that money is haram. Any extra money that I gain from this is haram in Islam. The time that I come, I am supposed to write exactly that time. That is another form of lying. Sometimes there are another kind of lying. And this comes also sometimes on the minbar. Some people lie on the minbar too. See, mashallah, sometimes we don't talk about ulama, we talk about anybody else. But sometimes we have to tell the truth. Sometimes certain people, they sit on the minbar to say certain things because they want to please the audience. I call them entertainers. The entertaining audience. Well, when you sit on the minbar, it shouldn't be entertaining. No. When you sit on the minbar, it's not about you or the audience, it's about him. What he wants is what you tell. Whether they are happy, alhamdulillah, they are not happy, too bad. Because it's not from you, it's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know the ayah of the Quran, الَّذِينَ يُبَلِّغُونَ رِسَالَاتِ اللَّهِ, those who are spreading the words of Allah, وَيَخْشَوْنَهُ, and they fear him. وَلَا يَخْشَوْنَ أَحْدًا سِوَاهُ, and they have no fear for anybody. Imam Zain al-Abidin, when he entered the castle of Yazid, and he wanted to sit on the minbar, listen to what he said. He said to Yazid, he said, allow me to sit on this podium. لِأَقُولَ كَلِمَاتٍ لِلَّهِ فِيهِنَّ رِضَى. That pleases Allah. And the audience also will also get the benefit and get the thawab for listening the truth. He made it the bottom line. As when you sit on a minbar, you have to tell the truth. That's it. But sometimes we sit on a minbar and we have to tell people what they want to hear. Even if it's not true. That is another lie. It's haram in Islam. Doesn't matter. That is another form of lie that a person should not do. And Imam Ali alayhi salam was told by the Prophet, do not lie under any circumstance. That is lesson number one. Lesson number two, the Prophet said to Imam Ali, وَالْوَرَعُ فِي اللَّهِ فِي وَعَ وَلَا تَجْتَرِعْ عَلَى خِيَانَةٍ أَبَدًا. Never, ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, betray anybody. Allah. Betrayal is haram in Islam. Somebody trusts you with something, you betray them, it's one of the bad acts in Islam. You know, one of the history that we read about Muslim bin Aqil, when he went to Kufa, his host, Hani bin Urwa, he said to him, ya Muslim, our only problem is Ubaidullah bin Ziyad. If we can kill him, we good. Then Muslims say, so how can we do it? He said, I have a good friendship with him. What I will do, I will invite him for dinner. And you stay in the room because he doesn't know you're here. As we eat it, I'm going to signal to you. And as soon as you hear the signal, you come up, strike it, and kill him. And done deal, we finish. Muslims say, okay, good deal. We accept it. They invited Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad. He came. They have dinner. They were eating. Then Hani ibn Urwa started signaling. Muslim didn't come home. The second one, he didn't come home. The third one, he didn't come. The fourth, the fifth. Then he started signaling one after the other, one after the other. Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad was smart. He knew that, no, this is not a normal thing. It doesn't look like, it looked like there is a plot here. He excused himself and he left. He didn't come home. After he left, Hani ibn Urwa went to Muslim. He said, yeah, Muslim, what happened to you? Are you sick? Somebody stops you? I said, no. They said, but one hadith of the Prophet I remember stopped me. What is it? He says, سَمِعْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ يَقُولَ الْمُؤْمِنْ لَا يَغْدُرْ وَلَا يَقُولَ Mu'min will never betray anybody. But he promised? He promised. How did we betray him? He said, listen, when you invited him, did you invite him to come and fight? He said, no. What did you invite him for? He said, for food. Okay, why do you even attack him and kill him? He said, no, I wouldn't kill him. Allahu Akbar. Muslim bin Aqil refused to kill them, and it was the golden opportunity that he could kill him and get it done with and take the leadership that the Imam Hussein sent him for. But he refused. He said, no. Even though that caused him his life. That is the importance of trust in Islam. When somebody trusts you, Imam Ali was told by the Prophet, never ever betray anybody. And you know Imam Zain al-Abidin salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. He said in one of the hadith, he said, I swear by Allah, if the killer of my father, which is Yazid or Shimr, he said, if he brings the sword he slaughtered my father with and gives me that sword and said, I trust you with the sword. He said, I swear by Allah, I will protect it and keep it until the day he comes and takes from me. How far can you go with the trust of his father? His father, Imam Hussein Ali, the killer and the sword. He said, I will protect the sword and make sure that I return it back to the person. That is to tell us the importance of keeping the promise and not to betray it. And when we say betrayal, some people think about money. No, no, there are different level of betrayal. Sometimes people, somebody comes and entrusts you with his wife and his children problem. MashaAllah. Then as soon as they leave, it becomes BBC. MashaAllah. Did you see this brother? They have this, ABC. Then the list go down. Allah. That's haram in Islam. You're betraying them. They trusted you with their secret and you're supposed to keep it as it is. You're not allowed to do that. That is haram in Islam. The Prophet told Ya Ali, never ever betray anybody under any circumstance. And this hadith doesn't matter whether the person is a Muslim or not, because when the Prophet was telling Imam Ali, he didn't say you should don't betray a Muslim or a Shia, no. Because sometimes we get this wrong notion that, you know, I'm not supposed to betray a Muslim, but it's okay to betray a Kafir. No. Any kind of this, like this of Imam Ali, Imam Zain al-Abidin, who are you talking about? The worst human being on the earth, he said, I will still keep the trust. And the same line, anytime somebody trusts you with something, you're not supposed to betray the person. That is number two. Number three. The Prophet said to Imam Ali, وَالْخَوْفُ مِنَ اللَّهِ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَاهِ Fear Allah. As if you see him. Even if you don't see him, feel that he sees you. Just because you don't see him, doesn't mean he doesn't see you. He sees you. He said, feel that. Fear Allah in the way that you feel that Allah is in your presence. And he sees you, and he watches you, and he will hold you accountable. That is the fear that the Prophet is telling Imam Ali to fear. And you know, there are three different kinds of fear. One, they said, Al-Khawf min Allah, there is awam. The general people, their kind of fear of Allah, they say is to stay away from all the sins. يريد سورة النازعات وأما من خاف مقام ربه ونهى النفس عن الهوى. Fear of Allah is abstain from any kind of sins. That is number one. There is the second level which is higher than this. This is what is called الخوف الخواص. خوف الخواص. Not only they stay away from haram, they stay away from shubuhat. Shubuhat, anything is not clear, haram or halal, they even put it aside. They stay away from it. Something is not clear, it might be halal, it might be haram. Islamically said, you can take it as haram. But they said, since it's not clear as it should be, I will avoid it. That is khawas. Az-Zuhad, another level, which is higher than this. Az-Zuhad, they are higher than the khawas. Who fears Allah, even higher than this. They said, their kind of fear is not to stay away from Subhan. No, they even leave Al-Mubahat. You know Mubah? Mubah is this that is haram. But they stop it because they want to do something to please Allah. That is, it's called Al-Khawful Al-Zuhad. That is the three level. Then there is another level, so for awliya, that is different. But for people like us, we can be in the first level or the second level or the third level. One have to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of the ways to develop the fear of Allah is to always feel the presence of Allah. Always feel. Because one of the problems that we don't feel that Allah is around, the reason why we don't fear Allah, we forget that Allah is watching. That's a problem. We forget that Allah is watching. Somebody is there, he's looking. That's what we are lacking. Like one of the ulama, Ayatollah, one of our scholars in his book, he wrote about a teacher who had a lot of students. And he used to love some one of the students. He picked one and he loved him so much. And the reason he loved him is not because of something, because he saw that this student fears Allah more than the rest. And he became very close to that student. But the other student, they don't understand. They think the teacher is discriminating. He loved one student and not the other. The teacher wanted to teach them the lesson. He told all of them, I said, tomorrow we have something. Hey, what is it? He said, I have you to bring chicken, all of you, to bring a live chicken. Go to the store, buy a live chicken, bring it to the school. They all went to the store. Everybody's excited. Inshallah, tomorrow we carry chicken to the school. They all came with a live chicken. Good job, mashallah. Now, what is next? He said, now you're going to take the chicken back home. And your homework is find a place where nobody sees you and slaughter the chicken and then come back. They all took their chicken home. The next day, all of them came back for the chicken slaughter. Now tell us, huh? Number one, how did you slaughter your chicken? I said, me? Allahu Akbar, you would not believe. I went all the way in the forest. Nobody looking left and right. Nobody saw me. I slaughtered. Alhamdulillah. Barakallah. The second one, say me? I went to the bathroom, I locked up myself, nobody was there, nobody! And I snored. Number three, I said, I went under the bed. That is how much I can go, right? Everybody told this story until it got to the student that the teacher loved the most. Here, this chicken alive. See what happened? You're supposed to love to slaughter the chicken. That's your homework. He said, yes, but you had one condition. And the condition is to slaughter the chicken where nobody sees it, and I never find any place where I go that Allah is not there seeing. That is tough. But if we get to that level that I feel somebody is watching, then I become more cautious about what I say. Then I'm cautious what I listen. Then I'm cautious what I eat. Then I'm cautious about where I go. Then I'm cautious what I look at. Then I'm cautious about what I do. Because I know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to hold me accountable. That is advice number three. Advice number four. The Prophet told Imam Ali alayhi salam, he said, كثرة البكاء. a lot of crying. Crying for what? Not because I lost money in the stock market, no. Not I'm crying because I lost something, no. I said, kathratul buka min khashyatillah. From the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know Imam Zain al-Abidin, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi? Is known as one of the five, the most crying people in the world. Imam Zain al-Abidin is one of them. He cries a lot. One of them also is Adam alayhi salam. Adam alayhi salam, after he lost his son, he cried so much. That is called the first crying person on the earth. That is one. Number two, another crying person on the earth was Yaqub alayhi salam. That Quran mentioned about him. He said, وَبِيَضَّتْ عَيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْحُزْنِ فَهُوَ قَضِيمٌ. He cried so much till he lost his eyes. That is number two. Number three, another one is also our dear Imam, Imam Zain al-Abidin, as we mentioned. Number four, some scholars say Prophet Nuh alayhi salam. Number five is Zahra alayhi salam. Zahra alayhi salam is one of the most crying women in the world. Crying is a good thing. If it is for the sake of Allah subhanahu. Imam Zain al-Abidin never reads Quran and he comes across an ayah or a verse that talks about a hellfire unless he pauses. And he cries. And he asks Allah, Ya Allah, don't put me in that situation. He reads the Quran, he gets to the ayah, talks about heaven, he pauses. And he asks Allah, Ya Allah, include me among those who will be having this blessing. And it's mustahab for us to, as we read Quran, to pause whenever we see this kind of eyes. Even if you don't cry, at least pause and ask Allah to refrain and keep you away from these people. That is Imam Zain al-Abidin. He's known as one of the most crying people. And it's very important. Anytime you cry for the fear of Allah, it brings you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is advice number four. And crying, you know, in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about crying, it increases your iman. Crying, when somebody cries for the sake of Allah, for the fear of Allah, what it does is it increases your faith and your closeness to Allah. And not only that, it's the best time Allah accepts your dua too. When you started crying for the sake of Allah, for the fear of Allah, that is the best moment Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his door of mercy for peace in front of you. And that is another important advice of the Prophet to Imam Ali. Say, Ya Ali, also, kathratul buka bin khashyatillah. That is number four. Number five, then the Prophet told him, Ya Ali, badlu malika wa damika lidini. He said, get ready to spare two things for the sake of your religion. One, your money. If you have something that your religion requires, he says, share it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is what? Number two, your own blood, if it requires to. Give your life and give your money. And amazing, when you look at the sin of the Prophet, he mentioned first your money, and then he mentioned the blood. The same thing you see in the Quran. Most of the places where Allah talks about giving, sometimes he mentions about giving money, and then he mentioned about life. You know why? Because the secret is here. If a person cannot give their money, forget, they're not going to give their lives. Because life is more important than the money. So if somebody is so greedy, they're not willing to give money, then they will never even give their life for anything. But if a person has the courage of giving, sharing with whatever they have, then chances is, even if their blood is required for Islam, they will give it. That's why Allah always said, الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ وَأَنفُسَهُمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. Amwal, money, and then the life. And this is also one of the qualities of a good man that is willing to give up everything for the sake of Islam. to give up even their own blood. Like Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam, they give everything they have for Allah. They give even their lives for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the life, our lives is important. In Islam, when you compare everything with your life, life is more important than everything. But when you compare life with Islam, which one is more important? Islam is more important. That is how it is. Everything is less important compared to our lives, but Islam is more important than our life. That is why Ahlul Bayt themselves, they give themselves for Islam. That is how important Islam is. The Prophet ﷺ said, Ya Ali, get ready that you're willing to spend everything. And you can see all these advice as we mentioned, if you go to the life of Imam Ali, did he practice them or not? Yes, he did. I'll give you an example. When the Prophet said, spend your money, Imam Ali alayhi salam, he never ever left anything with him. Never didn't leave anything. Everything he had, it was given back to the people and poor people. And you go to Imam Hassan alayhi salam, what they ask him after the child of Imam Ali, what did your father leave behind? He said, Inna abi lam yukhallif safra awala bayda. He said, my father didn't leave any gold or diamonds. This is in return to other khulafa who died and they found tons of golds and diamonds and silvers with them. Some of them, they left thousands of animals. Camels were supposed to be a lot of money back in those days. But Imam Ali alayhi salam died and there was nothing. What was the money that he made? Because Imam Ali used to work. Imam Ali used to have a farm that he worked in for the Jewish people. And he used to earn his money, but anytime he earns, it gives back to the people, to the needy. That is one of the quality of Imam Ali. That Imam Ali, the Prophet told him, and he practiced that. The second one, giving your blood. Did he give his life for Islam? Yes, he did. Everything that the Prophet mentioned, Imam Ali practiced them exactly as the Prophet asked him to do. That is number five. Number six, then the Prophet told him also, it says, وَالْأَخْذُ بِسُنَّتِي. Practice with my sunnah. What is my sunnah that the Prophet wants Imam Ali to do? He said two things, two sunnah I want you to do. One is praying, one is fasting. The sunnah for the prayer, he said, my sunnah is to pray 50 rak'ah every day. The Prophet says to Imam Ali, every day, make a time to pray and perform 50 rak'ah on daily basis. That is one. Number two, for fasting, it's a fast 3 days every month at least. How can I fast? How should I fast? It's the first that the Prophet mentioned. He says, Ya Ali, if you can, in every month, it's every first Thursday of every month, it's a fast on that Thursday. Then the next, in the middle of every month, find Wednesday and perform the fasting on Wednesday. The third, it says, and then fast also the last Thursday of every month as well. 3 days of every month. One, Thursdays of the first week of the month. The second one is Wednesday of every month, in the middle of the month, and then the last Thursday as well. 3 days a week. Allahu Akbar. Now let's say I can't fast 3 days a week. It's too much. Here they say at least fast 1 day. 1 day a month. Fast 1 day. In the hadith, we have another hadith that it's also mustahab to fast on 3 days of every month. They call them ayyam al-bayd, which is 13th and 14th and 15th of every month. That's also mustahab. Allah, brothers and sisters, if we can just practice this fasting and praying, I don't want to take you too long. Just make a calendar. And if you can follow just this saying of Imam Ali, the Prophet to Imam Ali, just practice them for 40 days. Just 40 days. And see how this can turn your life for better. Just this one. If you ask, I'm going to practice the saying of the Prophet to Imam Ali alayhi salam, which he did practice. Now I want to follow that footstep.
Allah, your life will be different after 4 years. I guarantee you that for sure. Spiritually, you'll see that you become a completely different person. Because these are golden words of the Prophet to Imam Ali alayhi salam.
That is another one. Then the Prophet didn't stop there. Then he continued, said, Ya Ali, after that,
Fasadaqa. Give charity.
Amma sadaqa, he says, give charity until you think you are wasting, but you're not wasting.
Give charity as much as you can until you started to think, am I wasting or I'm not wasting?
Then the Prophet says, as much as you think as you wasted, he said, you're not wasting anything because you're doing the right thing.
In Islam, what I saw, brothers and sisters, is that when you go to the Quran,
every quality Quran mentioned about mu'mineen, about muttaqeen,
one thing that is common all the time,
in the quality of muttaqeen, the quality of mu'mineen, the quality of salihin, the quality of mukhbiteen,
they always have one thing in common.
And that thing is what?
Is they have the quality of giving.
Imam Ali alayhi salam, he comes to the salat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا وَلِيُّكُمُ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ وَهُمْ رَاكِعُونَ.
Even in the middle of the prayer, Imam Ali is giving. That is how significant it is. And when we say giving, brother, it doesn't have to be so much. Even some little amount,
a dollar you give for sake of Allah, and 20 cents you have, you give it for the sake of Allah,
is counted as a lot in the sight of Allah.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not like you and me. When you give somebody $10, say, what am I going to do with $10? Allah, you give me a penny, he said, Alhamdulillah. He praises for just $1, for even less than that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala evaluates that. And values it as well, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves any person who has that quality of giving.
The Prophet told Imam Ali,
Ya Ali,
have the habit of giving.
Then he continues. He says, Ya Ali,
he says, number 7, Wa alayka bi salat al-layl.
Observe the night prayer.
And amazing, all this that we mentioned from 1 to 6, every one of those 6 that he mentioned is mentioned one time. And when he comes to Salat al-Layl, he mentioned 3 times.
Salat al-Layl,
he said, perform it and perform it and perform it. And Salat al-Layl, brothers and sisters, is very important. Even if one cannot do it on a daily basis, let's say one time a week.
Tomorrow is my day off. I'm not working. Tonight I have a chance. I can wake up just before the Fajr, 30 minutes, not more than that.
That is enough to do all the mustahabbat. And you get closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Ali alayhi salam and Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, they never miss the Salat al-Layl. And this Salat al-Layl is so important
that the narration stated that even if you're not able to perform at night, it's mustahab to do qada during the daytime.
Then how are we going to do the qada? Allahu Akbar. Islam is amazing. Allah knows that we are busy, right?
So he says, Salat al-Layl is important that even if you don't have a chance to do it at home, they say you can do it walking. You can do it driving.
Now if you're not the driver.
Even if you stop at the traffic light, you want to do Salat al-Layl, you can.
Allah, that is how easy Allah made it, Salat al-Layl. It's so important that the Prophet, and look at it, you want to do the important Salat al-Layl. You know, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, on the night of Ashura,
Tasu'a, the night of Ashura, they came and they wanted to do the fight that night.
Imam Hussein said, no, I want to perform Salat al-Layl that night. He and his companion, all of them, they spent the entire night doing Salat al-Layl. Dear, the Prophet told Imam Ali, Wa alayka bi Salat al-Layl.
And you know Imam Hussein alayhi salam, they put Salat al-Layl. Before his Shahada, He did not ask Zainab to do anything for him. Other than two things. When you look at the will of Imam Hussein, two things he asked Zainab to do. Number one, he said, "Ya Zainab, take care of the children." One. Two, he said, "Remember me in Salat al-Layl." Imam Hussein alayhi salam tell Zainab alayhi salam, he said, when you wake up for Salat al-Layl, remember me in your Salat al-Layl. Allahu Akbar. Because Salat al-Layl is absolutely different. Fajr, Zuhr, as we all do that, but Salat al-Layl is absolutely something different. Yet the Prophet tell Imam Ali, he said, do not forget about Salat al-Layl. And he mentioned that three times because of the importance of it. Then the Prophet continues. And he says, also there's another salat also. He mentioned two salat. One is Salat al-Layl, the other one is Salat al-Zawal. What's Salat al-Zawal? Al-Zawal is evening prayer before the Maghrib prayer. Which is called like Salat al-Asr. Al-Asr. You know what is called Asr? Salat al-Asr. In Quran is called Salatul Wusta, the middle prayer, because you have Fajr and you have Dhuhr, the two prayer before, and then there is Asr in the middle, and then there is a Maghrib and then Isha. So the Salat in between is called Asr. And Asr is one of the also important prayers in Islam. Why? And listen carefully, why is it called Asr? Asr in Arabic, it means pressure. Al-Asr, it means pressure. Now, the Asr is called pressure because it's the time that people start to feel the pressure of the day. In the morning, they woke up, they're strong, they go to job, they have their coffee, they have their tea, they're strong back and forth. By the time of Asr, everybody's looking at the clock. Oh, it's time to go home. Now I'm tired. I have enough of the day. They're ready to go back at that moment. People start to forget Allah. That moment, remembering Allah is the most important. Because people are now into the pressure of the day. They mostly forget Allah. And the same thing, Salat al-Layl, because people are asleep at that time, they forget Allah. Allah says, whoever wakes up at that time, he gets special treatment from Allah. The same thing, Salat al-Zawal. And Salat al-Zawal can be two rak'ah prayer. At that moment, to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet said, wa alayka bi salati al-layl, wa alayka bi salati al-zawal. Then he continued, the Prophet says to Imam Ali alayhi salam, he said, wa alayka bi tilawat al-Qur'an. Never forget that book of Allah, Qur'an, which today we ignore. Those of us, we will remember our Qur'an once a year. And that year is month of Ramadan. I know most of us do now, we don't even know where the Quran is. Until we hear tomorrow is Ramadan. Then we search, we find the Quran, and poor Quran is covered with dust. Then we wipe it, we start reading it. Until the night of Eid, it's Khuda Hafiz. We'll see you next year, inshallah. Done deal. That's it. While Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam, he said, a mu'min supposed to read, a mu'min means the follower of Ahlul Bayt, supposed to read Quran at least 70 ayah every day. Every day. A mu'min supposed to read the Quran. I can't read the Quran. It's a lesson to the Quran. Because now nobody has an excuse. Before you say, I never been to Arabic school, I can't read it. Yes, but you can listen to the Quran. Even if we can't read it, we have CDs, MP3s. That everybody can listen. Now there's no excuse. Imam said, the Prophet tell Imam Ali, read the Quran as much as you can. Because Quran, reading it, even if you don't understand it, it purifies you from inside. The Prophet said to Ali, Ya Ali, wa alayka bi tilawat al-Quran. He said, read Quran on every situation you find yourself in. And then he says, wa alayka bi raf'i yadayk. Raise your hand for du'as. Never forget asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's very important. One of the good ibadah also is asking Allah. Allah loves people who ask Him. Allah loves those who want to ask, even if they don't get what they want, they continuously asking. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called those who don't do du'a arrogant. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ إِبَادَةِ
People don't make dua, Allah calls them arrogant. The mu'min is supposed to ask Allah every day, every time. Ask Allah. Even if you don't have anything to ask, ask for other mu'minin.
Ask Allah for other sick people, for other Muslims, for other people in the world. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for their peace. Ask Allah for the fast recovery of the sick ones.
Imam Ali alayhi salam was told by the Prophet, Ya Ali, is always raise your hand and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Another one, the Prophet said to Imam Ali, he said, Wa alayka bisiwak inda kulli wudu.
Brush your teeth at the time of every salah.
At least three times. Because we do the jamak. You have Fajr, you have Dhuhr, you have Asr. Imam Ali alayhi salam was told, Ya Rasulullah, the Prophet told Imam Ali, he said, brush your teeth three times. Allahu Akbar. I guarantee you, if you follow this, you have nothing to see dentist. If you follow this tale of Imam Ali and the Prophet, three times a day you brush your teeth, you will find, you will pass by a dentist and you say salam, and you're not going to get inside. Because your teeth will be taken care of, and this is advice of the Prophet. Today, you know, one of the things that cause a lot is to go and see dentist. MashaAllah, one fillings is thousands of dollars. And God forbid if you break a tooth. Right? Now the filling and whatever other, MashaAllah. Now Imam Ali was told by the Prophet, Ya Ali, if you want and you follow this teaching, three times a day, you brush your teeth before the salah. He says that also keeps your teeth stronger and you don't need any person to look into your teeth. That is the Prophet Imam Ali alayhi salam. And then also the Prophet said,
the last one he says, Wa alayka bi mahasin al akhlaq. Follow the good character and the manners of Ahlul Bayt. And stay away from all the bad characters of the bad people. These are the 12 golden sayings of the Prophet. Now, if any one of us, now let's say these 12 is too much. Now my suggestion is take one out of these 12 and say, today I want to listen to the Prophet's advice and I want to take just one of it and let me practice with myself. Just one. And then after you become better with one, then take two. After you become better with two, then take three. And as you go, and I will just even say, brothers and sisters, Alhamdulillah, the year just started. We all have a resolution for every year, right? Different opinions. I want to go back to school. I want to get a better job. I want to relocate. I want to lose weight. I want to do this. We all have this. Now, put this as part of your resolution of the year, that I want to practice these 12 sayings of Imam Ali alayhi salam. At least one of it every month. One every month, I want to practice. Now that 12 is how many? That's a year. And you see that these 12 qualities of the Prophet that is telling Imam Ali alayhi salam, you will become a different person, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to follow these sayings of the Prophet.
Ya Ameen. Ameen.
Ameen.
May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to practice them on our daily lives.
Ameen.
And Ya Allah, don't let us be just the listeners. Let us be the also who listen and practice what they listen.
Ameen.
Ya Allah, we ask you, let our today be better than yesterday, Ya Allah.
Ameen.
And let our tomorrow better than today, Ya Allah.
Ameen.
Ya Allah, as we grow in age every day, let us grow closer to you every day, Ya Allah.
Ameen.
Ya Allah, grant us the tawfiq to be the true servant of yours, Ya Rabbi.
Ameen.
Wa sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
If you have a few questions. Yes, brother.
Regarding the first advice online, what's the role of exaggeration? I mean, exaggeration is part, you know, how would you define mubalagha?
Yes, the question is about exaggeration. Exaggeration is sometimes people's, they want to make people to laugh. or you want people to be surprised about something. So what they do is, sometimes they add their own spices. You know, like when you cough, you add spices to make it better. So they add their own spices to make it more enjoyable for the audience. Here they said, if it doesn't include anything that is live, right? Let's say, for example, something is at this size, but I added another size, but it doesn't look like too much. They said that is okay. But if it's going to be something that I'm adding something that is absolutely not there, but I'm making something up from myself, then that is wrong. That is lying. No one should not do that. Yes. Yes.
Just now you mentioned that we can do the Shab Namaz or
yes.
Tahajjud Namaz even while driving, and we have always heard that Maulana Ali used to pray all the time, and
yes.
That's all. So how do you do it?
Number one, let me say, Maulana Ali doesn't pray all the time. No. Maulana Ali also eats. He sleeps. He works. Right? Maulana Ali alayhi salam is like the Holy Prophet. They said that every person is supposed to divide their 24 hours into five. Islam doesn't say that, mashallah, lock up myself, Allahu Akbar, Subhanallah, Sami'Allah, Liman Hamidah, Sabib al-Sajjadiyah, Mafatil Jinan, Al-Quran. Okay, what are you going to get your food? Who's going to pay your mortgage? Well, Islam doesn't say be like that. Islam says divide your time into five. Like the Prophet Imam Ali says, he said, my 24 hours is divided into 25. One, he says, I have time that I go for job, I work, because work is part of the ibadah too. Because when we leave to go to our work, it's part of ibadah, because that is where you earn, you take care of your family. That is ibadah too. Now, that is one. Number two, he said, wasa'atun, I have another time, li ahli, for my family. Which we're missing today in America most of the time. There have to be a family time where we sit at the dinner table, we talk, we laugh. I ask my children, how was your day? What did you do today? What did you learn to school? I have to ask him. I want to know, who are his friends? What did he hang out with? So I know who are the bad influence, who are not the bad influence. That is time that you have to share with your family. You have to take them out to the dinner. Take them out to sightseeing. That is part of your family responsibility too. That is number two. Number three, and you see Imam Ali is doing all of that. Sometimes, family time is to be in the kitchen with your wife. Like Imam Ali used to be with the Zahra alayhi salam in the kitchen. That even the, because unfortunately today we think that, no, kitchen is for ladies. Dining room is for men, because we have to sit there and then they bring the food. That's where we're supposed to be. No, that's not the case. Imam Ali alayhi salam, he used to go into the kitchen with Zahra alayhi salam. The Prophet used to come in the kitchen. And you see, both of them are working side by side in the kitchen. And then the Prophet said, who should I help? Then Imam Ali said, no, Zahra needs help more. Then the Prophet goes and helps Zahra alayhi salam. So kitchen can be a time for the family. So that's number two. Number three, it says, Sa'atun li ashabi, another time for other people outside. I have a neighbor, I have family members, somebody has a baby, somebody is sick, I go visit them, I call, I go to see other people, I invite them over. That is time for other family members. They have right upon you too. That's number three. Number four, it says, Sa'atul li Rabbi, time for Allah. Where you wake up, you pray, you read your dua, that is time for Allah. And then the fifth one is time for yourself. Where you sleep, and you relax. That time, there is no namaz, there is no job, it's just for you. So that's how we're supposed to divide. Yes, it doesn't have to be divided equally because it depends on the need, but one have to divide their time in big manner where they have time for all these responsibilities.
MashaAllah.
Yes. I have two questions.
Yes.
One is, I heard that you can read Salatul Layl after 12 o'clock, is that correct? And secondly, if you cannot read the Quran every day and you can sort of listen to it in the car or wherever, is the reward different or is it the same?
Yes, the question number one is regarding Salatul Layl. When is the right time to pray Salatul Layl? The Salatul Layl is not, it starts at the midnight. And midnight, depending on the changing of the time. Sometimes it starts at 11 o'clock, sometimes 11:20, depending on how the time changes. Sometimes it's midnight that are 12. So from any time from the midnight, one can start the Salatul Layl. But the best time is close to the Fajr. Because midnight when you wake up, you do your namaz, there is still 6-7 hours for Fajr. Then you go to sleep, then you oversleep. Fajr comes, you're gone. Right? So Islam said, instead of waking up twice, one for Salatul Layl, and the other one for Fajr, it's better to wait until close to the Fajr, you wake up once. You do a Salatul Layl, right? At the time that you finish your Salatul Layl, Salatul Fajr comes, and then you become Salatul Fajr, and you're able to get the both together. So that is the best time to do the Salatul Layl. Yes. Yes.
Sometimes, if you wake up and you are doing Salatul Layl, and Fajr time starts, is it okay to continue with that, or should we stop?
The question is, when you start praying Salatul Layl and then the Fajr time comes in, so what should you do? Should you stop or should you continue? Now, if it's like, let's say, 2-3 minutes Fajr time, and you just have one rakat to finish, it's not a bad thing, you can finish and then you go to Salatul Fajr. But if, let's say, I woke up there 3 minutes before Fajr prayer, now I want to start my Salatul Layl, no, then you're going to miss the Salatul Fajr. So at that moment, you leave the Salatul Layl, and you do the Salatul Fajr, because Salatul Fajr is more important than the Salatul Layl. Even our scholars, they said, if you are to wake up for Salatul Layl, if it will, you're waking up for Salatul Layl will affect your Fajr, they say you are not allowed to wake up for Salatul Layl. Because Salatul Fajr is more important, because that is wajib. And this Salatul Layl is mustahab, so mustahab should not affect the wajib.
Yes. But the thing is, like, sometimes, like, we, like, I'm sure everybody must be doing it, but, like, Shifa and Witr only. Mm-hmm. So that's okay, right?
Yeah, that's fine.
There's a discount. You know, if you cannot do it, you know, all the 4, 4, 12, 11 rak'ah, Islam says yes. Even if you cannot do the whole Shifa and Witr, you can do just the Witr. That's
yeah.
Fine. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not that hard. We just make it hard for us. If you can't do 11, just 3 rak'ah. Shafi'i wal-watr, that's fine.
Yes, please.
I heard according to
our
Sistani,
so
you can read Salatul Layl after 11.
Yes, we cannot read it at the Maghrib because that's not the timing.
No, you can wait. You're saying we can.
You can, yes, I'm sorry.
We can read after Isha.
After Salatul, yeah, mustahab, you can read it anytime. But the preferred time that it was assigned is from the night prayer, from the middle of the night. Because when you look even Surah Al-Muzammil, when Allah talks to the Prophet, He said, "Qum al-layla illa qalila nisfahu." The middle of the night, awan kusminu qalila. But yes, there are some maraja who says that you can do it even before, and that is okay. Like said, Sistani, that's fine. You can do it after Maghrib.
How
the
niyat is as a sunnah?
Yes, Salatul Layl mustahab qurbatan ila Allah.
Yeah, I have a question. Completely different subject.
Yes, please.
Little lighter, maybe, inshallah. Mm-hmm. Which Shariat did Rasulullah follow before the pronouncement of the prophethood? Number one, that's the question.
Which Sharia?
Yeah.
He followed.
Is it the Banu Ismail? And I want to understand the concept of what trust or witness that has been sent to Abdul Muttalib and Abu Talib. What is that trust and witness that historians and talked about in the riwayat?
Yes.
What is that has come to Abdul Muttalib and came to Prophet Muhammad?
Yeah. The question is, number one, which Sharia did our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did follow before his prophethood? That's the question number one. Number two, what is the trust that Allah has given to Abdul Muttalib, which was transferred to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Number one, in the regarding of the Sharia, the Prophet himself is a sahib al-Sharia, so he doesn't follow any Sharia, except his Sharia. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he came to complete the previous Sharia. So when the Prophet came, all the Sharia that came from Adam alayhi salam up to Isa alayhi salam, They are all connected as one. The Prophet came to complete that Sharia. And that is what it is that you see on the day of Ghadir, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Al-Yawma Akmaltu. Kamal is complete. Meaning, all the religion that Adam started it, now the day of Ghadir is the day that the religion became complete. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not a follower of any other religion. He was the leader of his own religion. And besides, the Prophet is the leader of everybody. So he can't follow somebody's religion because he's the leader. The others supposed to be following him. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he came, he was acting according to his own Sharia. But at that time, people, our mind was not ready to grasp that responsibility. So he has to give it us like small doses. Now like a baby, when a baby is born, you're not going to bring him biryani and say, mashallah, this is a chicken, please go ahead. Well, he doesn't have a teeth yet, right? So you have to start giving him milk slowly, then bread slowly, then he has the teeth, then he can... The Prophet, when he came, people were like babies. So he has to start giving us what? Slowly, but it's all like, for example, at that time, he said, Kulu la ilaha illallah tuflihu. Say la ilaha illallah, go do anything you want to do. That was the first dose. Then people come, Ashadu Allah ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammad Rasulullah. They drink, they steal, they cheat, they do all kind of things, and it was fine. Because at that age, they cannot grasp that. So then later on, that no, you can't do this, you can't do this, you can't. Until the day of Ghadir, where everything was complete then. That's number one. Number two, about the trust of Abu Abdul Muttalib alayhi salam that was given. Here, they said that there are different hadiths and different interpretations from our scholars about that trust. They said that every time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to have someone that care about his trust. It's called mithaq. Mithaq is a covenant that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave. There will not be a time that somebody is not there to create the covenant of Allah. Now, after Isa alayhi salam, there was nobody, because there was no prophet after Isa alayhi salam, so that covenant was transferred to Abdul Muttalib alayhi salam as like the representative and the deputy of Ma'soom on the earth at that time. So he was like the caretaker of a ma'asum who was missing at that time until the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came. Then he transferred that covenant to the Prophet, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took it from there. That is one saying. There are other sayings as well that inshallah we can talk about it in the details inshallah. Yes, last question.
Yeah.
Yes.
You mentioned that to fast three times during the month.
Yes.
What niyat do you do for this fasting? Because it's different than the fasting of Ramadan.
Yes. First of all, if one has any wajib fast, you can fast on those days too. Kabat ma for dhimma. If you're missing one fast or any other fast, you can fast on those days. But if not, if you just want to follow the sunnah, the niyat will be sunnah that I'm fasting, mustahab, or sunnah, qurbatan ila Allah ta'ala. That I'm fasting this mustahab fasting to be seeking closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes.
So,
Sheikh,
you mentioned that there are
That's right. First of all, Salatul Layl, when you miss it, let's say I woke up, like brother said, I woke up and it's not enough time to pray Salatul Layl. Now I just have to do my Fajr prayer. Now, it's mustahab to perform Salatul Layl when the sun already rises. If you can, they say wait and do it during the daytime. It's better than to do it at the time of Fajr. But in case, let's say I'm going to be busy during the day, I can't have the time to do it because of the work, then one can do it after Fajr, and there is no problem. But the preferred time is afternoon. When the sun rises, it's the best time to do the salat. Pay that back. Wa sallallahu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.